हेलो एवरीवन, आई एम धर्मेंद्र शेठ फ्रॉम सूरत। वी हैव जस्ट स्टार्टेड दिस लाइव स्ट्रीम एंड वी आर वेटिंग फॉर सम फ्रेंड्स टू जॉइन। वी विल बी टुगेदर फॉर अबाउट एन आवर और सो। इफ देयर इज समबडी ऑनलाइन ऑन आवर फेसबुक पेज, can you please write something in the chat box to check whether the messages that system is working properly? If you just say hello, that is fine. Welcome to this session. It's a very informal session, friendly session, so please feel free to write your comments in the chat box. So let me begin by introducing the people on the screen. In fact, there are some more likely to join later, but right now we have three people on the screen. One obviously is me, yours truly. Then we have in the center, Shaili Sheth. She is a student of biotechnology. She's in the final year, waiting for her final exams. Shaili, you can say hello.
Hello.
Just to check whether the audio, video, everything is okay. And the third speaker, the key speaker today, is Man Dhanik. Now, he is a very creative soul. He has multiple, actually, talents. He is a voracious reader. He is a DJ. He is a fantastic communicator. I have known him since his childhood because his father and I, we have been close friends for a long, long time. And Man, he looks like Harry Potter in a way. So probably that prompted him to read all the Harry Potter books, and he has seen all the movies, he has read all the books, he has taken part in discussions, so he will be able to help us understand the charm that Harry Potter books and movies has from adolescent point of view, because I'm sure he started reading many years ago. So the fourth person who is likely to join very soon, she is Janki Trivedi. So Janki and Shaili will ask questions, and I will also pitch in whenever it is possible. And viewers can also ask questions via chat box, because I have a facility to check your chat box and your questions. And I will present your questions to Man, and Man will answer the questions wherever possible. And it's a very informal, friendly session, so please feel free to interact. So, Man, let me begin by asking questions, first of all.
Yeah, sure.
What is special about Harry Potter? Why do so many people, people of every age, actually, because I have seen some students of standard 7-8 talking about Harry Potter, some students of higher secondary, people of my age, right, even older than me. So there must be something special in Harry Potter which, you know, attracts everyone. So what is special? What is your opinion?
Probably because everyone wants to relate to magic, I guess, because everyone wants to believe in some way that magic is real. I guess that's what, and to children, basically magic is very intriguing. So I guess they start by watching movies, and then they later, if they are more interested, they will dive into the books. So
okay,
I guess it is because magic is very intriguing for the children and people of older age, I guess, because the writing is really not only for the children. It is also very interesting for the people who are, you know, above their 30s or something.
Okay.
So I guess that's because everyone should watch it or read the books.
Yeah. So what you are saying is that language also has its own special quality in Harry Potter books, right?
Yeah.
Is it difficult? For example, if a student of from a vernacular medium school, say standard 8 or 9 student, if that person wants to read, is it possible?
Like if he is interested and then he will try to read it, because it is not that difficult to, the first few books, it is really easy to, you know, understand what the writer is trying to say. So if you are interested, then you can definitely read. It's not a problem.
Okay. Shaili, in between, you can also ask questions, because I have so many things, so I'll keep asking one after the other.
Okay. So, Man, can you say... Yes?
Yeah, go ahead.
Man, can you tell something about the character of Harry Potter?
So, like, I'll tell you the first character that everyone wants to know is about Harry Potter, right? He is the main character in this. So, he is a guy from, I guess... he lives with his uncle and aunt. Like, they don't treat him very well. So, he doesn't really want to live with them. So, he is obviously looking for someplace else to be. So, that turns out to be Hogwarts for him. Hogwarts is his school where he learns magic. And there he meets his two friends, Ron and Hermione. So, these two guys are his classmates and his best friends. So, the whole movie and the whole stories revolve around these three guys and a few other characters. Actually, there are more than 100 characters. So, but the whole concept of the story revolves around these three people. Yeah.
Man, you mentioned that there are about 100 characters. Yeah. So, are they all introduced right from the beginning, or gradually they are introduced in books?
So as you start reading, the first book introduces the most main characters that will be there throughout the movies, right? So the first book introduces to us the most familiar characters that will relate, that people will relate to in all situations. And as you go on reading, the second book introduces more characters, the third one gives us a few more, and as the story keeps unfolding, it will give you more and more characters as and you can see how the writer has a real subtle way of introducing characters. Like, for example, Sirius Black, he is the godfather of Harry Potter. So she doesn't introduce Sirius Black until the third or the fourth book. So a really important character is not introduced till the fourth book. So, you can say that she has a really, you don't know what character is going to be important until you really read about them.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Shaili?
So, Man, can you tell about the founders of Hogwarts?
So, Hogwarts was found by four people. Right? The first is Salazar Slytherin, Godric Gryffindor, Rowena Ravenclaw, and the third one is Helga Hufflepuff. So, these are the four people who founded Hogwarts, like, thousands of years
back. Can you repeat that, please?
So, the first founder is Salazar Slytherin. So these are the four people who have named, you can say the four houses in Hogwarts are named after these four guys. So we all have, in our schools we have yellow house and blue house or something like that. These Hogwarts has four houses like Slytherin, Ravenclaw, Gryffindor, and Hufflepuff. So these are the four founding members of Hogwarts. So, yeah. And
Why are
each
these
house
names so
has their own.
strange?
I don't know. But thousands of years back, I don't know, people had a different mindset.
Can you say some characteristics of each house?
Yeah, so as we know, Slytherin is known for their cunning behavior. They are like really cunning, and they are known to go to any means to, you know, get what they want. And Gryffindors are said to be, you know, brave and well-mannered, I suppose. Yeah, brave and well-mannered. And Ravenclaws are supposed to be studious and, you know, very witty in a way. And Ravenclaws, I've spoken about Ravenclaws. Hufflepuffs, yeah. Hufflepuff people in the Hufflepuff house are supposed to be very friendly and, you know, kind-hearted.
Okay. So how do they decide, suppose there is a new student, then how do they decide where, what particular house that student has to go?
So whenever new students come in, like there is a ceremony called the sorting ceremony. So each student has to sit under a sorting hat. So that hat decides for you that which house you're supposed to go into.
Okay.
And
right.
Every student, the students don't usually get to decide where the, which house you are supposed to go into.
Okay. So is there some kind of ceremony during, like in our schools also, during the admission, there are some formalities.
Yeah.
So is there anything like that in?
Yeah, so whenever the new students come in, the first thing that happens is the sorting ceremony.
Okay.
Yeah.
What
so
is that?
So all the students are the sorting ceremony.
Okay.
Sorting ceremony. So every student is brought to the
sort.
So every student is brought to the main hall, and everyone has to sit under the sorting hat, and people and their seniors are also present there. So they also see who's going to be in our house and who's going to be in the rival houses.
Okay. So there is rivalry as well.
So there is a house cup, right? So every year there is a house cup won by one group, one house. So the house which is best behaved or has won the most points wins the house cup every year. So in a way they are rivals. Right.
Okay. Right. Right. You said that there are about 100+ characters. So if you have to select three of your favorite characters, who would you call them? Your three favorite characters.
First one, I'd say Luna Lovegood. She was introduced in the fifth or the sixth book, I guess. She is actually a very introverted person, so I kind of relate to her. The second one would be Sirius Black. Sirius Black is also, as I said, the godfather of Harry Potter. He is, I guess, one of the most influential people in Harry's life. And his character is actually really inspiring. If you read, you will know that he has inspired Harry to do a lot of things that without him, he would not have achieved.
Okay,
Third
you are about to
say.
Is
Severus Snape. Severus Snape is
what
the
is special
headmaster
about that
of the Slytherin house. He is the headmaster of the Slytherin house, and like he is the definition of unconditional love. So the Chamber of Secrets was guarded by the three-headed dog called Fluffy. He was Hagrid's pet, apparently. He was a giant three-headed dog. Like, and the only way to, you know, make him go to sleep was music. So somehow these three kids got him to sleep. So
why was Harry Potter living with his uncle and aunt, as you said earlier? What happened to his own house and parents?
Harry Potter's mother and father died when he was really young, like, and he had no other options but to live with his uncle and aunt, who really didn't treat him well. He used to sleep under a cupboard, under the staircase in a cupboard.
What sport do the students at Hogwarts play?
So the only sport I
Sport.
think they play is, they play a lot of Quidditch. So it is a sport where you are riding a magic broom. You are flying on a broom. Seven people in your team, the rival team has seven people as well. So you're trying to catch this golden snitch. It's a really small flying ball. You're trying to catch it. The seeker, the person who's trying to catch the golden snitch is called a seeker. So every team has one seeker, a goalkeeper, and two, I guess. And every other person, so the person who catches the snitch wins the game. So if Harry Potter was a seeker, right? So his job was to look for the golden snitch in the entire match. If he catches that snitch, his team wins. So it was a really interesting sport. I like. There was also a World Cup played in the fourth movie. There was shown a world. They show a World Cup played between Ireland and I guess some other team. I don't remember.
So, how many points do you get for catching the snitch?
If you catch the snitch, there's 150, 100 or 150 points. You get 150 points and your team wins automatically.
Okay.
Can you say something about the writer of Harry Potter books?
Okay, so J.K. Rowling, right? Amazing writer, first of all. New York Times bestseller for all of her books, I guess. Mostly all of her books. She has written seven Harry Potter novels, I guess, and other prequels of Harry Potter novels are also there. Fantastic Beasts series is also a prequel of Harry Potter. They have shown Dumbledore's youth in that. We have seen some parts of Voldemort in there. Like, she has a really unique way of writing stuff and introducing characters. As I said, she has a really subtle way of introducing characters that are the most influential the final story, right? So I guess she appeals to a really broad audience, not only kids or not only adults. She appeals to all of them. I guess that is a special thing.
Right. How is the whole school system managed in these books?
Like what?
As you mentioned, there are some houses, and there must be
Okay.
somebody controlling everything, planning rules or forming rules, etc.
Okay, so the headmaster of this school is Albus Dumbledore, right? He like he is the rule maker. I in some way or the other, he is the final guy who makes everything, every rule. So he was also present when Harry's mother and father died. So he was the one who took Harry to his uncle and aunt, right? That is the first scene in the movie. So I guess Albus Dumbledore is the one who awards points to houses. So if you've won a match, won a Quidditch match, he awards points. If he feels that you've done something really brave or something really smart, he will award points to that house. And the at the end, like, the house with most points wins the house cup.
Okay. At what age did you start reading Harry Potter books?
I was
Or in what
11 or
standard were
12 years
you
old.
when you started reading?
11
Okay.
or 12 years old, I was. my mother used to take me to the library to read. So I used to read there, and then I used to come home, and then I also came to know that there are movies about this. So I started watching the movies too. Then when I grew up, then I bought some books when I could afford. So mostly I read in libraries.
So what did you like more, books or movies?
I'll answer your question first. So the books actually are not for everyone, because not everyone can read 7 books. And you know, each book is almost 500 pages long, so it's not for everyone. But if you are interested, you should definitely read. Movies, I guess, are a little bit shorter, but they don't cover the entire story in some sense, because a lot of things that you read in the books is not present in the movies. I think if they would have, you know, shown some things in the movies that were really good, and some things were, you know, changed in the movies.
Okay.
So I guess if you should do both, read and then watch the movies.
So, from what platform do the students board the Hogwarts Express?
The platform. It's called, the platform is not called anything, but it is known as the platform 9 3/4. So it is a platform like really discreet. It is located between a general platform on a London trainway, like subway. You just have to run through a pillar between the platforms 9 and 10. So you'll end up in a platform called 9 3/4.
In one of the movies, I saw some creatures flying. So any idea about that?
So like what kind of creatures? Can you describe them?
Like I remember watching a part of a movie. Some like students were eating something, and there were some flying creatures. They came and
the ghosts, like the translucent kind of ghosts.
Something like that. So what was that?
So they are the alumni, or you can say the, you know, the people who used to be in Hogwarts before. So there is, each house has their own separate ghosts as well, you could say. There was nearly Headless Nick, if you remember. So he is a, they also have some moving pictures and talking pictures on the walls. So it's all school that you'll never see, in a type of school that you'll never see. But like there is a lot of things in there that you'll never see in the real world. Ghosts in a school, like someone has a rumor in a rumor, like our school has a ghost, then literally the next day everyone will go and see where is the ghost. But for these guys it is very normal, like there's a ghost, I know.
So, what kind of subjects did they have at Hogwarts?
Like, the subjects that they had were very different from what we have. We have maths, and everything. The subjects that they have are Defense Against the Dark Arts. So, they have to defend themselves against the forces that try to, you know, the black magic, basically. And there is, I guess, Defense Against the Dark Arts, and there is botany. They also have a type of botany where they learn about magical plants and magical magical plants, basically. In the second movie, there was a scene about mandrakes. So the mandrake juice was really useful for them. for the people who were petrified by the Chamber of Secrets, right? So they learn about those kind of things, and then there is potions. They also learn how to brew potions. So Severus Snape, as I told, was the potion master in the second and third year. Mostly throughout the movie is the potion. And the position for the Defense Against the Dark Arts teacher is like really cursed. It used to change every book or every movie. Like there was a new teacher every year.
Like goods with Harry Potter logo. So is there any particular system for that? Like, do they get any royalty? Like you see t-shirts and different kinds of things available. Like,
yeah, because they have practically this a business now. There's a website that tells you what house you are. So there's a website called Pottermore. So you can sign up there and they give you a quiz. So you can find out what house you belong to. And they have literally all kinds of merchandise available for Harry Potter. Okay. So they've, I guess, made this a business now.
Right.
Who was Filch at Hogwarts?
So, Mr. Filch is basically the caretaker. You can say we have wardens, right? For the dormitories, we have wardens. But over here, we have Mr. Filch. He was the caretaker of the place. Like, he used to clean the stuff. He used to make sure that the children are in bed after bedtime. So he was that guy. He used to look actually really scary. And he had a cat too. Like the cat's name was Mrs. Norris, was her cat, his cat. Like, and he was actually a really peculiar character.
So what was Philosopher's Stone, the first novel which is about it?
So the Philosopher's Stone the Philosopher's Stone is a magical artifact. You can say. Artifact. It was locked in a bank, the Gringotts Bank. In the first movie, like, you can see Harry Potter and Hagrid going into the bank to take that stone, and they actually, when I told you about Fluffy, right, the three-headed dog, that dog was supposed to guard the Philosopher's Stone. So that stone had the powers to bring back the dead. So people were trying to use that stone to bring back Voldemort from the dead. So yeah, people almost succeeded, but Harry Potter stopped.
So, Man, can you describe something about Gringotts?
The bank, yeah. So, it is a bank run by elves. No, not elves. Yeah. So, it is a bank run solely by elves. So, elves are said to be really, you know, intelligent creatures. Like, they are really good at doing banking and all that. So, it is a bank solely run by elves, and they are not very friendly, actually. As you can see in the last movie also, there was a scene in the Gringotts Bank. I'll not spoil a lot of the last movie. So there was this elf called Dobby. He was a really good friend of Harry Potter. Like, he, unlike other elves, was really friendly, right? And he wanted to protect Harry, and then he was, I guess, a house elf. He was house elf for the Malfoys, the Draco Malfoy and his family. Like, and Harry saved him from, you know, his duties. Like, he was not really happy with his duties because he had to do the housework and everything. So Harry saved him, and like from then he was a really, you know, really good friend with Harry Potter.
In one of the movies, there was some bird, and then it turned into ashes, and then again there was some kind of rebirth.
The phoenix.
What was that?
That was Dumbledore's pet. It was called Fox.
Is there any significance like of that bird in the movie?
So yeah, so in the Chamber of Secrets, the phoenix brings Harry his sword, which he uses to fight the basilisk in the end, right? So, and the phoenix, it is in their world, it is said that phoenix's tears have healing powers. So Harry uses his tears to, you know, heal the wounds, heal his wounds, because if he would not have used his wound, you know, healed his wounds, he would have probably died because the basilisk's fangs were poisonous. So, and you said that they convert into ashes, right? So, Dumbledore said that whenever they get old and like they are really weak and old, so they turn into ashes and they are reborn from that those ashes only.
Sherry, next message.
Man, can you tell something about the spells which are used at Hogwarts?
Yeah, so there's also a class for spells. Like, there's a teacher that teaches them spells. One of the most famous ones is like the Wingardium Leviosa. It is a levitation spell. Like, if you use the Wingardium Leviosa spell on something, an object or a person, like it levitates in the air. So basically, you can make things levitate with that spell. There are other spells too. Like, there's a spell called Stupefy. So it is used to disarm your opponent. Like, if your opponent is pointing a wand at you, a magical wand, you can use that spell to disarm your opponent. There are like many other spells. The one that is used the most is basic. I can say Stupefy is the one that is used, and the other one that is really famous is Avada Kedavra. So that is a killing spell, not used by a lot of people, but Dumbledore usually does that. No, not Dumbledore. Okay. Voldemort and his dark army usually use that spell to, you know, kill.
Someone tell something about Hermione and Ron, Potter's friends.
So Harry Potter's friends, right? Hermione and Ron. So both of them are also from the Gryffindor house, same as Harry Potter. So Ron and Hermione, right? So Ron belongs to a family called the Weasleys. Ron Weasley, he is kind of a joker or a funny guy in the group. So he's always goofing around and, you know, just making fun of things. Hermione is really studious. Like, she is worried about the exams even before they have announced the exams. So she studies everything. She is acing every class, every test. But she is also a really passionate friend. Like, she will, if Harry Potter and Ron are in some trouble, like, she will go and save them some. So in most cases, Hermione is the reason that these two guys live to tell the tale. So,
Man, what appealed to you most while reading books? Was it the characters or the magic or the way of narration? What appealed to you more?
In a way, I guess it was a little bit of everything, but The when I was little, I didn't understand how clever the writing was, so I don't know. So when I grew up, I read them the books again, and then I understood how good the writing was. So yeah, at that age, I didn't understand that, but at that age, I was like really intrigued by the magic and stuff, and it was really fun to see these three guys going on adventures everywhere. And so in a way, it was really fun to read.
So, Man, can you tell something about
Sorry, next.
Deathly Hallows?
That
Deathly
the
Hallows?
Deathly Hallows. Okay, so the Deathly Hallows is a story in its own, right? So the Deathly Hallows can be when they are three things, right? The Deathly Hallows consist of three things: the Resurrection Stone, the Elder Wand, the wand that Albus Dumbledore uses. So that wand, the Resurrection Stone, and the Invisibility Cloak. These three things make Deathly Hallows. So basically, the story behind Deathly Hallows is that the three brothers, they are trying to cross a river, right? It is so the river was not, it was a trap set by Death himself. So the three brothers use magic to build a bridge over it, but they are stopped by Death. So Death comes to a conclusion that you three can go, but you and you can have Death will grant them one wish, one wish each. So one brother asks for power. So so he was given the Elder Wand. The other brother wants to bring someone back to life. So he was given the Resurrection Stone. So the third and the last brother, he just wanted to go away from this place and not be followed by Death. So Death gave him a piece of his own cloak, which was the invisibility cloak. And in the end, the two brothers who wished for power and the Resurrection Stone, they died immediately after a few days. But the other guy, he lived a really happy life and, died of old age. So in a way, it is a message that you cannot chase power, or you cannot live in the past. Like, you cannot. What can you say? It's really philosophical, I don't.
Yes, we are
Can you
lucky
tell
to
something
have
about
Dr.
Hagrid?
Girish Pawar with us.
Hi, hi
Yeah,
everyone.
Man, you can answer this last question. Yeah. Man, you can ask this last question and then we'll listen to Dr. Pawar.
Okay. So Hagrid, right? Hagrid was, let's say, a friend of Harry Potter and Hermione, the three guys. Like, he was a really friendly person. He was also present at the time of, when Harry Potter was really small, and Dumbledore was there too. In the first scene of the movie, where Dumbledore gives his uncle and aunt. Harry Potter is given to his uncle and aunt. So Hagrid is also a very emotional person because he also cried while that scene. And Hagrid, like, he is always helpful to these guys, like, even when they are in trouble, like, he will help them out. And he has a knack for really weird pets. He once brought a dragon's egg. He had a really, the Fluffy was also Hagrid's pet. Then in the fourth, no, in the fifth or the fourth movie, Hagrid had a, what was it? I forgot his name. He, like, basically, he wants to, have pets that are really, really wild. No one has ever heard of such.
Yeah. Now, I think Dr. Pawar is disconnected once again. There is a problem with connectivity today in many parts of India, I guess, because of this rains. So, Dr. Pawar, if you are online, you can throw some light on the topic.
Yeah, I'm
it's nice to see you.
Can you. Yeah, yeah, same here, sir. Same here. Nice to see you for the first time. And of course, the budding Potterheads and already a head, maybe two heads here. Thanks, Man, for your observations on Harry Potter. Now, I may not remember everything that Sherry and sir are asking, but what I remember is my journey with Harry Potter had been amazing, and perhaps not really had been, but it is has been. It is
okay.
Never-ending process for me.
Very cool.
It's perhaps one of the best reads.
Please
sorry.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry for the technical glitch.
Okay.
So yeah,
I was this problem
that,
right?
Yeah. So it has been a wonderful experience. Mine was more in the mode of reading and analytical aspect of reading. How Man, right in his first answer, how he pointed out that perhaps it's magic, which enchants everyone and gives us hope. For me, it began with a simple book that my sister had gifted me, and she said, "Can you do something with this text?" And it's amazing how the text talks to you, and it's one of the texts that you can't really keep away. You can't just stop thinking about it, what happens next. My research was all about how the story unfolds throughout. And the way, I mean, what makes one sit for almost seven books, more than 4,000 pages? What makes you do that? There are plenty of other texts, but you don't do that to the other texts. I mean, think about the popular text, for instance. I'm not sure how many of us have read J.R.R. Martin's Game of Thrones. People prefer show and not the text, because the texts are humongous, mammoth of texts. But it's also wonderful read. Only point being here is it's simple at the same time, complex in places, which makes it unique at the same time, which keeps us in loop of interest, ease. Textual tension is very interesting to observe. At the same time, perhaps the way the story unfolds, as Man said that the first three texts are very easy. At the same time, the later books, the last four are perhaps for different audience. They are perhaps for different demographics as well. Because every country has a different kind of response to Harry Potter text. If I could take liberty and offer about a little bit about translation. Now, it's a very clever way how J.K. Rowling advertised his books.
Then we have connectivity problems.
It's a very clever way of
selling
your product, which is a global product in a sense. I can't see you guys.
So we can hear you.
I'm sorry. I hope I'm not interrupting too much.
No, go ahead.
As I was saying,
that
the text has its own unique way of unfolding and unraveling those stories. And it's beautiful to sit through it and to experience that. And as I was saying, that the later four texts are meant for perhaps some different kind of demographic. I was talking about translation study.
Now, after second and third volume of the text, people were so engrossed in the text, especially in Europe, people could not really wait for the English, the translations, especially in French and German. Now, what this text has also done remarkably in modern times, it has brought back a new readership, which was so involved into, let's say, the fancy internet. We're talking about 95, 96, 97, later and the early 20th hundreds, 2000. And the text actually brings back a huge readership who want to learn English language. Who?
Okay.
French. Come on. French, you know, I mean, if French people are reading English, imagine the impact that the text would have had. So they would actually smuggle these books from UK. We have two publishers, Scholastic and Bloomsbury. Bloomsbury represents UK and Scholastic is for America. So look at that. I mean, how many texts have done that? That's what I wonder. And readership and in modern times, we say what is popular is not really worth reading. But this particular text challenges it. It in fact, is a brilliant crossover of popular, classic, at the same time, maybe a children's literature, which was struggling for a very, very long time. So that makes this text very, very unique for me. When I look at this journey, it just still there is a magic in it. As Man said, still there is this magic in it, which keeps us in loop. So that's my observation for now. You please continue with your questions and queries if you have.
I believe you also worked on narratology with respect to this particular set of books. So if you can say a few insights, you can share a few insights. Shelly, you can ask a question meanwhile. Last question, probably.
Okay. Man, tell something about mudbloods. What are these things?
Okay. So, mudbloods and pureblood, basically, in Hogwarts, like, this is a thing with mostly Slytherin house, right? So, the purebloods are people, basically, whose parents belong to magical families, right? So, magical families are people who have been practicing magic for a long time, basically. And mudbloods are people whose family are not entirely into magic, right? For example, Hermione's parents were dentists. They were not magic. They were not following or practicing magic, right? So, in the school, some students used to create a bias based on purebloods and mudbloods. The entire second book and the second movie is about killing mudbloods, basically.
Yeah, Dr. Pawar, you can continue from where you stopped.
Okay, so my research basically was on and about a theory called structuralism, which looks into the way a story is rendered, the technical aspect of it, which I will not get into details, otherwise I'm sure I'll make you sleep. I have that confidence for sure. Now, what I basically did, I looked at each and every narrative strategy. I'm speaking to one particular point, which is how a story unfolds, or who's the vocalizer or focalizer for per se, and who leads the story, what drags the story. So for instance, in my observation, I realized that all seven books talk to us in seven different ways, which not a lot of people have yet agreed to. There's still, of course, there are crossovers. You do not have one particular genre for one particular text. For instance, I begin with the first text I call Bildungsroman. Again, a very technical term, which means coming up of the age, or coming up to the age. Yeah. That's what the genre represents. But you can't also say that the first text is only about that. The first text is also about something called Kunstroman, which is also making of an artist or a hero or a teacher for that matter, which again is represented in the fourth and fifth text. The second text I realize is more of detective in nature. Try the detective fiction where he goes into chamber. There are a lot
I think we have a lot of connectivity issues today.
Yeah.
But I think it will be very interesting to have a full session by Dr. Pawar on narratology, keeping in mind Harry Potter's books, right? So that we have more time to discuss each and every aspect of writing that J.K. Rowling used, you know, the devices that she used.
Yes.
And how does it appeal to a large audience with different backgrounds, different even cultures? One of the biggest surprises to me is that Harry Potter books, if you see the background, it has a particular kind of background, Western background. Right, though magical, but it is Western background, and still it appeals to people of all ages, all cultures, all backgrounds. You know, even if you look at the economic background, social background, academic background, all backgrounds are different, but still people love to read and watch movies, Harry Potter movies. So what is the latest one in the series? Is there any other book coming up? Any idea? Any news?
So the series has ended. Like the seventh was the last.
Okay.
One. They are coming up today. Like they have published, you know, a script of the play that is the Harry Potter and the Cursed Child. So they have they are performing a play in London. Like they've done a lot of shows with that play. So you can buy that book in bookstores right now. It is available, but it is not a continuation of the story. But you can also, if you want to watch the prequels, like there is the Fantastic Beasts series. So they have two movies out right now. So two movies of Fantastic Beasts. You can see younger version of Dumbledore. Yeah, but the Harry Potter storyline has been ended.
Right. So I think we can end the session here because the fourth person was supposed to join. She couldn't join because of some technical problems. So anyway, next time we will have a better connectivity, first of all, so that we can have all the questions. In fact, Janki Trivedi, she also had about 20 questions. She was curious to ask you, but because of this poor connectivity, she was not able to join. Initially, she was able to connect, but now I don't know what happened after that. Yeah. But anyway, so it was very interesting. Thank you, Man, for this session.
Yeah, my pleasure.
And I hope those who watch this video later, they will be motivated to read and explore in their own ways. Yeah, because everyone has their own experience. When I read Harry Potter's books, I derive pleasure from a particular set of things. When Shaili reads, she will have pleasure from some other areas, right? So everyone will get or derive pleasure from different styles, different elements of story.
Yeah.
So I hope everyone who has watched this starts reading and watching movies also in English. And it is one of the tools, I would say. For those who are English language learners, I would say this is a very powerful tool. Use it as a tool.
Yeah.
Because if the story is interesting, you will continue reading and automatically it will help you improve your command of English. So I very strongly recommend this series. So thank you very much. And we end the session now. Thank you. Shaili, thank you for being with us.
Bye.
Yeah. Bye.